And Lord, as we look back on this past year, just this brief activity, we know this is just the tip of the iceberg, Lord. There's been so much to thank you for. Surely you are good, your love endures forever. And we thank you, Lord, for what lies ahead this year. All the even more wonderful things that you're going to do, Lord. We thank you now for your word. We pray that you will speak to us, and we know that everything, Lord, that you speak to us brings light and life into our lives. So come, Holy Spirit, grant us fresh revelation, fresh vision, we pray. In Jesus' name, Amen. Alright, so Matthew chapter 2, I am reading verses 1 and 2, and from 9 to 11. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea, during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star in the east and have come to worship him." And then verse 9 onward, after they had heard the king, and then we know the story that the king consults scribes and Pharisees and all of that, and finds out about Bethlehem being prophesied in Micah. After they had heard the king, they went on their way, and the star they had seen in the east went ahead of them, until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshipped him. And later we know about the gifts and all that, but I'm not focusing on that today. So this star is often called the Star of Bethlehem. If you say go to YouTube and all, you will see a lot of videos on what was the Star of Bethlehem. Okay? But of course, it wasn't the Star of Bethlehem. It was in fact the Star of the Messiah. Because the wise men say, the Magi say, we saw his star. We saw his star and we have come to worship him. When they saw the star, they were in presumably Babylon, the most likely place where they were. So it was not the star of Bethlehem or Babylon. They say we saw his star, so let's call it the star of the Messiah. I won't even say the star of Jesus, because they had no idea that his name was going to be Jesus or Yeshua. They saw a star, they knew that the star signified the Messiah. We'll call it the Star of the Messiah. They say they saw it in the east, which could also mean they saw it because the sun rises in the east, that kind of thing. It could also mean they saw it when it rose or when it appeared. Okay. We saw his star when it appeared. And that may make sense, because Herod asked them later, when did the star appear? And most likely, as I said, these Magi were Babylonian wise men. And the question is, how did they know? This thing that they saw, how did they know that it was the star of the Messiah? Okay. Now the best way, the most likely answer is that they had scripture with them. Because the Jews had been captives in Babylon, not just for 70 years, but for many more years than that. Because we know that after 70 years, some Jews returned. But a huge number of them stayed on in Babylon. For example, Nehemiah, Esther, these were all people and their families who stayed on in that foreign country. They all didn't return. Okay? And so, they would have known from scripture. I'm just reading one scripture to you, Numbers 24 verse 17. A star will come out of Jacob, a scepter will arise out of Israel. So they have had this prophecy, for example, with them, giving them the country where this unusual king will arise from. Okay? But there's something even more interesting in Daniel chapter 9 verse 25. And Daniel, remember, became the leader of the wise men of Babylon. So you can imagine what impact he had on what they knew. And in Daniel 9 verse 25, it says, this is a very strange passage, I won't give you the details, but it says, "From the issuing of the decree to restore and rebuild Jerusalem, until the anointed one, the ruler comes. By the way, anointed one is the exact meaning of the word Messiah or Christ. So from the issuing of the decree to restore and rebuild Jerusalem until the anointed one, the ruler comes, there will be 7 sevens and 62 sevens. 7 sevens is 7 times 7 years, and 62 sevens is 62 times 7 years. And apparently that amount of time, I've not gone into the details, but the amount of years mentioned there is exactly the time between Nehemiah's decree to rebuild Jerusalem and Jesus' birth. So if they knew this, they were actually expecting something unusual to happen. They were expecting news of the anointed one, and around that time they see the star in the sky. So all of these things together gives us an idea of why these astrologers or wise men, pagan wise men, saw something in the sky and knew that it heralded the birth of the Messiah. And they come all the way to Judea to worship him. Okay. Now remember the Christmas carol, star of wonder, star of whatever, westward leading, still proceeding. And so we have this picture of them following the star. And I remember in All Saints, and I think it's quite a common thing, we had the star, you know, moving, one star moving, and the three wise men walking behind the star. Okay? Nothing of the sort happened. The Bible doesn't even tell us that. The Bible says clearly the star appeared once and then the star appeared again. It didn't go moving around with them following, which is, at one point I wondered, you know, why did they go to Jerusalem? If they were following the star, why would they go to Jerusalem? The fact is they were not following any star. They saw it when it appeared, they understood what it was telling them about. The logical explanation to them was, a king had been born in Judea, let's go to the capital city. And then later on the star appears a second time and leads them to, I mean, when they get to Bethlehem, the star appears a second time and leads them to the house. Okay, so they didn't follow the star. It appeared once when they were in Babylon. It appeared a second time when they were in Bethlehem. And between those two appearances was 2 years. So finally, just very briefly, what was the star? It was obviously not a star the way that we think of a star. It was not a heavenly body. So lots of explanations of what it could have been. It couldn't have been anything that we see in the sky, because nothing behaves this way. Okay, nothing moves from east to west. There is no star that can possibly shine over a particular house. And we are told very specifically that the star came and stopped over the actual house, not even over Bethlehem, but over the house. So what it was a supernatural light. And by the way, that word for star really means a scattering of light. Okay? So what's actually happened is that some very supernatural light has, God has spoken. Yeah? Yeah. No, so only from Jerusalem to Bethlehem. Till then the star is not around. It's appeared there, it's vanished, and now it's come to take them to the actual house. How did they get Bethlehem? They got it from scripture. They got the word Bethlehem from scripture, not from the star. But they get the actual house from the star. So we do have supernatural lights in the Bible. For example, we have the light at creation. When did the sun, moon and stars get created? Day 4. What was the light on day 1? It was something supernatural. Yeah, there was supernatural light on day 1, 2 and 3. And then the natural light of the sun, moon and the stars was created. We have the pillar of fire in Exodus. We have a light with them for 40 years, every night. Okay. Then you have the Shekinah glory of God over the tabernacle, which was a brilliant light. And so most people who want to look at what the Bible says, feel that this star was most likely the Shekinah glory of God that appeared to them and then appeared to them a second time, because the glory of God can travel and can rest upon, just like it rested upon the tabernacle. You know, it's actually quite symbolic that it rested upon the house. It stopped or ceased moving over the house, which is exactly what used to happen with the glory of God. It would rest over the tabernacle, which was of course the sign of God's presence, God's dwelling place. And here God was fully dwelling in Jesus. Yeah. So why am I telling you all this? Just some little background. Because I want us to learn something from the star. You know, we've learned from the shepherds, and we've learned from the wise men, and we've learned from Mary, and we've learned from Joseph, and from Zechariah, and from Elizabeth. And I realize the only character in the Christmas story left is this star. So why not learn from the star? Okay. So three aspects of the star. The first aspect is, it was his star. I love that line. Okay, we have seen his star. It was the star of the Messiah. Okay. So this star was unique. It was set apart. It was distinctive. It was like no other. These guys who studied the stars day and night recognized something completely unique and distinctive and different about this light in the sky. And understood like no other star or no other heavenly body or heavenly event, it heralded the birth of someone divine. Yeah? That was the first thing. The second thing about the star is, it proclaimed the good news of the birth of the Messiah. Somehow there was a proclamation and they understood it. Yeah? Where is this star? Where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? How did they know that? Somehow that was the proclamation from this star, that someone has been born King of the Jews, and there's something amazing about this person. He is the anointed one from scripture, whatever. Okay? Because that was the question they asked. Where is he who has been born King of the Jews? So they had received a proclamation about the birth of someone special. They didn't just say, oh, something nice is happening in Judea, let us go and see what's happening. It was a very specific thing that they understood from that star. Okay? And the third thing is, it led them straight to Jesus. It actually went and stopped over the house. It went ahead of them and stopped over the house. So we see three things about the star. You know where I'm going with this sermon, of course. It was his star. Secondly, it proclaimed the good news about Jesus, about the Messiah. I won't say Jesus yet because they didn't know his name. And it led them straight to Jesus. There's a verse in Philippians chapter 2 verse 15. Okay. In the middle of that verse, it says, Paul calls us to shine like stars in the universe. Okay. We are called to shine like stars in the universe. And that's what I've titled today's message, Shine Like Stars. And we want to learn from this most unique and amazing star. Okay. How that star shone, and what that star did, we wouldn't go very wrong if we could at least do that, to shine like stars in the universe. Now that word for star is a different word. It actually refers to brilliance, a brilliant light. Sometimes we have that word luminous. It comes from this word. Okay, we are told not to shine, to be brilliant like stars in the universe. And I'm suggesting to you that if you want to follow this and to shine like stars, let's learn from this star. Let's do the three things that star did at least. What was the first thing the star did? It was his star. So we want to be set apart as his. Okay? It sounds so simple. It is one of the worst things, my thing for the church, my heart for the church is that we will not be like the world. And we are so much like the world. It's disgraceful. Remember, we are called to be set apart. How many people look at How many people look at the church and think, oh yeah, they're so different from Rotary Club? No, they're not. I remember the first alpha we did, and it was a good thing. First alpha we did, first, second, or would have been the second series of alphas we did, 2001 or 2002. And one of the people who was part of All Saints for so many years, had been on the committee for many years before that, all of that was exclaiming about how he was benefiting from alpha, and said that, you know, I'm really learning something new now. Before that, it was just a social club. Church was just a social club. It was no different from any other club. In fact, it was worse than other clubs. At least other clubs, you get to play, eat food or something like we get. You don't even get that in church. But we're called to be set apart. So if you want to shine like stars in the universe, you know, to be his people, his disciples, followers, his children, his servants, his ambassadors, however you want to, all of these words are used. But to be seen as his, to be distinctive and unique like no other. You know what the word holy means? It simply means set apart. It simply means like nobody else. That's why God is holy, or holy, holy, holy. There's no one like him. And when we're called to be holy, it doesn't mean we're so be pious and look so good. It means that we're just so different. And automatically we'll be righteous and godly because the world is not. And the context of this shine like stars is, we're told to shine like stars, if you look at that passage, in a crooked and depraved generation. A crooked and depraved, both the words simply mean twisted and distorted. And Paul is saying the world is distorted, you've got to be different. Okay? And if we are his, we will be different. So that's the first thing, to be, just like the star was his star, we want to be his stars, his people, his ambassadors, completely unique and set apart. And people, we want people to look at us individually, want people to look at us as a group, as a church, and say this bunch of people is different, not like the world around. Second thing that started was what?
Proclaim the good news.
Proclaim the good news about Jesus. We want to proclaim Jesus. Okay. Secondly, it proclaimed about Jesus, and the passage goes on to say, shine like stars in the universe as you hold out the word of life. That's effectively what the star proclaimed, the word of life, the Messiah is born. We get to proclaim far more because we know far more. We can also talk and share and all of that. In fact, that word could mean two things. It could mean hold fast to the word, or could be hold out the word. And I want to use both meanings, because if we are his, how do we proclaim him? We hold fast to his word in our lives, and we hold out the word of life to others. Okay? And both of these things are important, because what is the antidote to the world's distortion? He's saying a crooked and depraved generation, they're twisted, is distorted. What is the antidote to that? It's the truth. It is the word. So we hold fast to his word in our lives, we hold out his word to others, and in that way we are proclaiming him. Okay? And the point is this, is that the world is waiting, and the world is seeking for this, even if they don't know what they're waiting and seeking for. And others are not ashamed to proclaim. So why are we? I just think of all, I'm the only word I can say, mumbo jumbo, that is being proclaimed around the world as the answer, as the truth, as eternal truth. Mumbo jumbo versus the word of life. If we are going to shine like stars, we should be proclaiming the word of life in an age of really mumbo jumbo that's all around us. What is the third thing that started? It actually went straight there, you know, went ahead and stopped, okay, to guide others to him, okay, to be set apart as his, to be seen as his, to proclaim him, but also to guide others to him, okay. The star went ahead. We have to go ahead of people. We can't guide the world to what we haven't experienced. I think a lot of proclamation, unfortunately, is just words. We can only guide people to what we ourselves have experienced, and that is what testimony is all about also. This is what I have experienced. Come in, share the thing. So we have to go ahead of people. If you want to bring them to Jesus, we have to be there first ourselves. That's the first thing. Secondly, what did the star do? The star did its job and then disappeared. Okay. We direct our attention, we direct the attention of the world to Him alone, not to ourselves or to our church or to religion or whatever. If we want to bring people to Jesus, that is our desire. What was the result? It says that they were overjoyed and then they bowed down and worshipped. If we can do these things, if we can shine like stars in a crooked and depraved generation, if we can even just imitate this star, this inanimate star, okay? Though I think it was the Shekinah glory, so it was something absolutely amazing. The result will be overflowing joy as people discover what they've been seeking for and didn't even know it was there. And they were looking for it in all kinds of nonsense. But all the while, it is there in the word of life that has been given to us. There will be overflowing joy. There will be worship. I want to end with one little scientific fact about stars. You know, we learnt in science that stars emit light, and planets and moons reflect light. Right? Okay. We are called to be stars. We are called to emit light. Okay. We don't have to just reflect. Because Christ in us, the hope of glory. That word glory is brilliance. It's the same word, brilliance. Brilliant light. Okay? As we soak in His presence, as Jesus is more and more present in us, we will be emitting His light. As we spend time in His presence, we will be emitting His light. You know? Let Jesus permeate us as we spend time with Him. And then we will shine like stars. Okay? We will be distinctive. We will be proclaiming Him, holding out the word of life, holding on to His word as well. We will be directing people's attention, leading people to Him. That's what the star ultimately did. Okay? It took heathen, pagan, sorcerers, people involved in the occult, whatever it was, it took them to Jesus and they worshipped Him. This is not really for the year ahead or whatever, this is our calling. We are called to shine like stars in the universe, in a crooked and depraved generation. Okay? Let's not talk about the good old days. Paul is talking in the first century. And he's saying it's a crooked and depraved generation. And today we're in the 21st century, either the 20th, 21st century, and we're still saying crooked and depraved generation. Therefore, the calling is the same. We're called to shine like stars. We're called to hold on to, and we're called to hold out this word, this revelation, this truth that we have to a world that is actually seeking and longing for it, whether they know it or not. Come, let's pray. God, what an amazing high calling You have for us, Lord. Not to lead just ordinary lives of religion, but to shine like stars in a crooked and depraved generation. To be set apart as Yours, to proclaim You, to guide others to You, to life itself. I pray that we may lay hold of this calling, Lord. Lord, give us Your heart for this world around us. And I pray that as we spend time in Your presence, may we be soaked, may we be saturated, may we be permeated, Lord, with You. that you may shine through us, that we may shine with your light, Lord. But we want to see this generation come to you, Lord. And we pray that you will use us for that kingdom purpose. In Jesus' name. Amen.